This morning we continue in our study of James. If you have your Bible, please open it to James chapter 2. James chapter 2, this little tiny powder keg of strength in the New Testament, written by a pastor to a church that has been scattered throughout the civilized world about 15 years after our Lord and Savior had ascended to heaven, leaving us with the task of being his representatives on the earth. So this morning we come to James chapter 2. There's been a series of tests that Pastor James wants us to verify our faith, to really look and see that we have true saving faith in Christ. He's concerned that people are self-deceived. He's concerned that people are religious but don't have a relationship with God. And so he unfolds through these five little chapters, not very delicately, but very directly. James's style is a no-nonsense style, which you're going to see in just a moment once again. And he's saying, do you really have faith? Do you really know Christ? And so I believe it's a very appropriate study for us because, one, it's in the Bible. All of the scripture is worth our attention, but especially in this day and time when there's so much confusion about true faith in Christ. So this morning we come to this test of faith minus works. What do you get? If you have faith, but you take works out of it, what is there? What is left? And James is answering that question. Pastor Ben began this study 2 weeks ago. Last Sunday, we diverged a little bit to Hebrews chapter 12. And this morning, we come back to James chapter 2. Do you have your outline? Notice there the box on the page. James chapter 2, verse 14 through 17 is really our focus this morning. But because it is good to read scripture publicly, we're going to read the whole section that deals with faith and works. And so we're going to notice 14 through 26 is this section where he is really dealing with faith and works and how they go together. Notice here in verse 14. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says, can you underline that? If someone says, that is a key phrase in what this whole thing is. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? Verse 17, so also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is what? Is dead. Verse 18, he goes on. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? Verse 21. Was not Abraham, our father, justified by works when he offered up his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works, and faith was completed by his works. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. Verse 24. You see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone. Earth-shaking statement. We will deal with that next Sunday. Verse 25. And in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. Now, He said it over and over in this passage. In fact, and he's really changed the tone in this little letter to the churches. Notice here, and fill this in these 14 through 26, we see six rhetorical questions. He wasn't asking a bunch of questions in verse 1 and 2 so much, but now we see six rhetorical questions. He is arguing a case. James, you thought he was meddling when he dealt with partiality? Now he's really meddling. He's gone from dealing with kind of some of this more surface heart issues that are personal to now he's coming from the personal inside look to the outside look of your life. And he's saying, it's not just personal. It's not just how you deal with trials. It's not just whether or not you blame God for the trouble in your life or the sin in your life. It's not just that you would receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls. All of that from chapter 1. But then it pours over into, how do you treat others that aren't like you? We spent 4 weeks on impartiality. The fact that our God is impartial. He is not a partial God. He looks on the outside. Excuse me. He looks on the inside as man looks on the outside. And we are called to be like him. That we would look on the heart. And so here we see that James is now arguing this point, yet another major issue about your faith and your works, and do they match? In fact, notice here with me, the word faith is used. Notice on the diagram, I know it's kind of hard to see a little bit. Do you see all those yellow boxes that are there? It's used 11 times in these verses. It's a key phrase that keeps coming, or excuse me, a key word that keeps coming up. When you study the Bible inductively, notice what it is saying. Notice what themes are there. Notice what is going on. That's why we look at the whole passage and we say, okay, how does this fit together? Notice the next part here. The word works. Faith and then works. And works, it shows up 12 times in these verses. So faith is being brought up, works is being brought up. And there's another very key word that is here in these verses, and it is the word dead. It is the word dead. How many times does it show up? Can you see it there? Three times. Three times the word dead shows up. And notice where they are. Look at verse 17. Circle the word dead at the end of verse 17. And then I'd like to ask you also to look at it in verse 26. The spirit is dead, circle that, and then works is dead. Faith apart from works is dead. These two verses are very, very critical conclusionary verses as the thoughts go. And the word dead shows up in both of them three times. James is not only saying that faith and works need to be looked at together, but there is a massive consequence that is involved with this, and it's death. It is a lack of faith. It is a faith that is not alive, and he's very concerned about that, and so he comes to that, and these two repeated phrases, I just mentioned them in verse 17 and verse 26, faith minus works is dead faith. Faith minus works is dead. It doesn't do anything. In fact, look at verse 20. If you wonder about the rhetorical nature of this, those six rhetorical questions that he's making, James is now prosecuting a point. He is making a point. And look at verse 20. And would you read verse 20 out loud together? It's a question, so read it as a question. Look at verse 20. Do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? So dead faith doesn't get anywhere. It doesn't get you anywhere. It doesn't bring God glory. Dead faith is useless. And here we see that he's turning up the rhetoric. Pastor James is getting in the people's face. And what does he call them? You foolish person. You say, I don't know if I like that pastor. I mean, I thought pastors were supposed to be warm and fuzzy and always approving. Well, you don't know me. I'm not always warm and fuzzy and always approving. And part of that is simply because God's word is a two-edged sword and it cuts down into our life. We live in a fallen world and our hearts are fallen. Our minds are depraved. You say, that pastor just called me depraved? Yes, the Adamic fall, when we fell into sin, even our thinking was disturbed, that we no longer have the clarity of vision, the sin that has come in and contaminated our minds and our hearts, and we are easily deceived, and we can easily run in deception, myself included. And so God's word comes to cut through all of that and to show us the way of God. And so when we see these words in verse 20, James is lovingly sounding the alarm. He's lovingly rebuking us. He's lovingly rebuking the person who does not look logically at what God's word has said and does not look lovingly at what God has said. God has made you logical. God has made you loving. He's made you both. And so we come to this, and James is seeking to alert us and to refute the falsity that so often comes. So he's saying to us in this strong rhetorical argument, consider it joy, everyone, when you go through trials. God is working in the trials. Have faith. Ask for wisdom and faith. He's saying, don't blame God for your troubles. Don't fall to that. Be genuine in your faith. Take care of orphans and widows and keep yourself unstained. All that's James 1. Don't be partial. And now he's saying, make sure that your faith has works that prove that it is there. So he's calling us to really look and to see. You see, James, part of James's big picture here is that he, in throughout the book, but especially here in these verses, he's dealing with hypocrisy. He's dealing with hypocrisy. Now, this is a big deal because human beings have a problem with hypocrisy. Jesus showed up pointing out the hypocrisy. Jesus showed up saying, you all like to be religious. He came to his own people. He came to the people of God, the Jewish nation. And here they were supposed to be walking with God in purity and righteousness, and they were not. They were filled with pride. They were very religious people very often. And Jesus showed up calling them to account for the hypocrisy in their lives. You know, it's very interesting that cultural Christianity needs to be called to account for the hypocrisy that is so often there. You see, if we're just skin deep in our Christian faith, if we're just, I'm okay, you're okay, we wash the car on Saturday, go to church on Sunday, look nice and pretty for everybody, you know, we got it all together, and then we go home and we go back to our lives, and our lives are not really living in honor to God, then we too, like the ancient Jews, are dealing with a lot of hypocrisy. And James is dealing with that. He's saying, your partiality is just very hypocritical. When you say to the rich man, oh, you sit here, and you say to the poor man, sit beside my footstool, that's filled with hypocrisy. And now James is saying, you say, oh yes, I have faith, but it does not affect your daily life. It doesn't affect Monday morning. It doesn't affect the contracts. It doesn't affect the conversations. It doesn't affect the attitudes. It doesn't affect the sacrifice of your life. You're just going to do your thing? James is saying, your faith is dead. And he's concerned for the individual, but he's also concerned for the church. Because if the church gets filled with people that are very religious, but they're not truly living by faith in God, living by faith that honors God, then the church becomes corrupt. And the church becomes sick. And so he's saying, no, you guard that. This is a pastor writing to congregation after congregation after congregation spread throughout the early first century world, and he's concerned that many of them are religious, but they're not very relational truly with God. And so he blasts away, aiming at the waterline of what is actual in your behavior versus what is a facade. You know, this is a message that is needed today because when, you know, there's a few top excuses that people give for not going to church, right? One of the ones is, well, they're always after your money, okay? Another one is, oh, well, you know, the pastors, you know, they're very ingenuine. I mean, we've seen decade after decade of TV preacher after TV preacher and other scandal and all of this other stuff that the pastors aren't really genuine. You've heard that before. How about the third one? Well, it's just a bunch of hypocrites. And Larry says, amen. Larry, there's nobody that's a bigger hypocrite here than me. If a hypocrite is defined very often by what you know and what you don't do, I mean, I've devoted my life to the study of God's word, not that I know the most of anybody in this room, but, you know, we are called to live not in hypocrisy, but in humility before God in obedience to what he has said. And we cannot do that in our own strength. We can only do that, as we'll see, in the gospel. So flip your sheet over and let's run to really look at 14 through 17 and just notice this. I had you on the other side underline that phrase in verse 14. Do you see it at the top of the page? It says, what good is it, my brothers? What does it say next? If someone says, he has faith but does not have works. So the first one here is the problematic claim. There's a claim that's a problem here. And the problematic claim is that James is saying there's many people who say that they have faith. There's many people who say that they are trusting in Christ or that they are religious in this way. And the picture is that James never, if you notice in all of these verses, James never says that this person has faith, only that they say that they have faith. You see, they make the claim, and it's not only they that James is speaking of here, there are many who make the claim. There are many who make the claim to have faith, but yet they do not have works that go with it. Now, number one, number two, and number three on your outline here, these flow together, and I want you to see this. First of all, there's the problematic claim, but secondly, there's the problematic understanding of faith. And this is what James is pointing out, that their understanding of what real faith is flawed. They misunderstand what it is. The pastors just recently went to something called Together for the Gospel this last spring. I think there were 11,000 pastors in one basketball arena, the KFC Yum Center in Louisville, Kentucky. And there we were. And in this tremendous gathering of pastors and elders in the life of the church and great time of challenge and preaching and really calling us to be careful about what we believe, One of the pastors that was speaking from Australia said, both in Australia and in the United States, I've almost stopped using the word faith. He said the culture is confused about the word faith. It can mean so many different things to so many different people. You know, from the George Michael song of you just got to have faith, got to have faith, got to have faith. I mean, when you apply that to a girl, you apply that to God, you apply that to all kinds of things. What does that really mean? What is the terminology here of faith? Is faith this mysterious thing that is just, well, let's look at a few of the things that are here that are possible. First of all, it's the idea of intellectual acknowledgement. That it's, okay, my faith is that I believe this set of facts. I remember as a child hearing my father say, you can believe in a set of facts concerning God and it not change your heart. You can have intellectual assent or intellectual acknowledgement of those facts and not be changed by it. He said that it becomes very little difference between whether you believe, well, Jesus Christ existed and this is what he did, and George Washington existed and this is what he did, and you know, you apply the same thing there. Don't I believe the right things? I've often heard it said that many people will miss heaven by 18 inches. How sad to miss heaven by 18 inches. The distance between the mind in the heart. That you believe the right things. The problem is you just don't do them. It hasn't changed your heart. It hasn't brought about a transformation in your life. And so it's more than just knowing the facts. How about this one? Many in our present day and time would think that faith is a feeling. Well, you know, it's all about the way I feel. It's my emotions. It's about the chill bumps that go down my spine. It's when the preacher was preaching and this really spoke to me and I felt this chill, or when we were singing that song and I felt this chill, or we were praying together and I had an emotional experience. Now, God made us emotional. There's nothing wrong with emotions. But our faith is so much more than a feeling. In fact, if you seek to live your faith by feelings, you will run the train in reverse. You will run in the opposite direction, living by feelings instead of living by facts. And that's a very dangerous thing to do. You see, Jeremiah 17:9 warns us that our feelings and our hearts will deceive us. We need to know the truth indeed. Notice the next part here. What about faith as a spirituality? There's a lot of, this is increasingly prevalent, not only in America, but even in Western Europe right now, and for that matter, in Eastern Europe. When we moved to France 12 or 13 years ago, there was a lot of talk about the fact that the French had for many years been very rational and complete when it came to issues of faith, not open at all, not open intellectually, not open spiritually whatsoever. When we were moving there, there were all these articles being written and newscasts and so forth about the opening of the French heart to spirituality. Well, you can be open to things spiritual and not be open to God. There are many people who have a very spiritual orientation on things, but the problem is, which spirit? Is it the spirit of the world? Is it the spirit of self? Is it the spirit of Satan? Or is it the spirit of the Creator who made you and is righteous and is calling you to come to Him in belief? You see, that Australian pastor that said, I rarely use the word faith anymore because it's so confusing. He said, I choose to use the word belief and trust. Have you come to believe in Jesus Christ? Not only that he existed, but that he is God and that he is the Messiah for your soul. And that have you come to, very key word, to trust him. Now, I know our pews are old, but many of you, when you sat down in the pew this morning, you didn't wonder if it would hold you up. You just sat down. Now, there's a couple of pews here in the middle that you might want to wonder that. I don't know. We prop them up, and we're trying to hold them together. You know, they're 45 years old now. But you're trusting that pew. In fact, that trust is so implicit that you hardly think about it. It's natural to you to do that. You see, part of this issue of truly coming to God is that you sit down in him. You completely rest in him. You come to that place of recognizing that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He promised that all who believe in him and all who come to him, he will in no wise cast out, that he will come and that he will forgive our sin. He will come and he will heal our hearts. And he says that I will take you to heaven if you have trusted in me. And so, it's more than the intellectual. It's more than the feelings. It's more than the spirituality. Listen to this. It's more than the tradition or the ritual. There are many that their faith is simply a tradition. It's a ritual. It's this thing that I do. And as good as it is to be very careful and diligent to come to worship together, there are some who think that by simply coming and being, quote unquote, at church, that I spent all those Sunday mornings in church, certainly God will let me into heaven because I gave him my Sunday mornings. Friends, we're not doing God a favor by being here. And the ritual of being here is not what saves us. We're not coming here hoping to be saved. In the word of Christ, we are coming here because we are saved. That he has redeemed us. You see, there's a very different picture there that flows throughout the issue of these works. How about this one? This is a very important one. Faith, the wrong understanding that faith as an ethnic or familial identity. That while our family is all Christian, so I'm a Christian. Or our ethnicity tends to be Christian, and so I'm a Christian. You see, this would be what we call nominal Christianity. It's by name. That you know, Americans tend to be Protestant. Or if you're Egyptian Coptic Christians, you would say, well, I'm a Coptic Christian, or I live in Beirut, and so I'm a Coptic Christian in Beirut, or I live in various other places of the world, and we tend to be this, or we tend to be that. Some are Muslim here, others are Christian here. This is so bizarre, but very often if you watch the news in certain parts of the Middle East, you hear about the conflict between Muslims and Christians. And today, Christians, you know, blew up four houses in the eastern part of Beirut as they are seeking to take over the stronghold Cartier or the neighborhood of the Muslim Hamas group and so on and so forth. And it's you even hear the word Christians in that. And if you go to those places and you were to really begin to talk with them, you would find that, well, this is more of an ethnic identity than it is truly the belief of the claims of Scripture that Jesus Christ was indeed the Messiah, the only hope for a lost and dying world. And so we come to the one that I have bolded here, that's the last one that is here. More than intellectual, feeling, spiritual, traditional, or some familial or ethnic identity, faith, a belief, here's that word of believe. Jesus said we must believe upon him. Belief in Christ's sacrifice that transfers trust, identity, and obedience to him. We're transferring trust from ourselves. We're transferring trust from our ethnic identity. We're transferring trust from feelings or ritual or tradition. We're transferring trust even from intellectual facts by themselves to the reality of God's call upon our heart and what He has said, and we choose that our identity is now in Him, our obedience is seen in Him. We're transferring not trust to ourselves, but to Him. Now, you see, the picture here is that the true Christian obeys Christ. The true Christian does not obey Satan. He does not obey the world. He does not obey the flesh, his own flesh, but a true Christian obeys Christ. And there's a massive difference in that. And that is what James is very concerned about. You see, and fill these in, just as Christ loved and obeyed the Father, as seen in his works of teaching and going to the cross or to his death, we too are called to love and obey the Father. We trust and obey what he has said. It's not merely that we have some facts or emotions or open spirituality or traditions. It's that we have been changed by him. So there's the problem of the claim that someone says, hey, I have faith. But do they really understand what that means? And James is defining what it means, and it comes down, here's the problematic absence, fill this in, the problematic absence of works. That works aren't present. That you have the right words, but you don't have the right actions, perhaps. You say, what works are required? I thought that Christ did all of the work. That's part of what we'll see over the next 2 weeks. But I want us to see here what James is saying. A life of behavior, what are these works? The works are a life of behavior that consistently conforms to God's word of truth and commands. The fact of the matter is that coming to Jesus, yes, means that you believe, means that you transfer trust, but that transferring of trust is shown in the fact that you obey his commandments, that you come to do what he said to do. James is absolutely concerned that people are coming together in the name of Judaism and in the name of Christianity now, and they are meeting together and their lives are unchanged. They're still being religious, and they even like the new twist that the Messiah has come. But the Messiah hasn't changed their actions. And James is saying, faith without works is dead. You don't know God. And I just want to share with you some final thoughts. And I pray that God does a work in our hearts this morning as we just look at this depth of the concern of this pastor's heart for us. God's heart for us. Number one, just because someone claims to have faith, it doesn't mean that they actually do. Just because someone claims to have faith, it doesn't mean that they actually do. Jesus showed up on the scene, and let me tell you that the average person that was there among the nation of Israel, and they did not understand what he was talking about at first, because they did not truly have faith in God. They had faith in themselves, they had faith in their religious leaders, they had faith in various other things, but they were lacking, they were downtrodden, and they were laden down with burdens of sin because the truth of God's word had not been being taught to them. And so they didn't have faith in God, they had faith in the wrong things. And even that is the case then, that is very often the case now. That people come saying, oh yes, I'm a Christian, yes, I have faith in God, when in fact they do not understand the gospel and they have not surrendered their life to the gospel. The fact that a Savior has died, he died in your place, if you trust in him instead of yourself, you can know him and experience his grace in your life, as opposed to, well, I'm just trying to get it together. I'm just trying to get it together. I'm just trying to, you know, make my life conform into something that is better than it was before. There is so much more than that. So just because someone claims to have faith doesn't mean that they actually do. Number two, it's better to humbly verify your faith than to proudly vilify, to make a villain. It's better to verify your faith than to proudly vilify someone who's questioning it. Now, some people could have been really upset with Pastor James when he wrote this letter that increasingly steps on more toes and more toes and more toes and more toes as he goes. And you know, you can shoot the messenger if you want, but it doesn't change the fact that sometimes we need to see what God is saying. You know, one of the things that I've noticed in the life of the church is this, that people who really know the Lord are so glad when someone asks them, are you a Christian? Do you understand the gospel? What is the gospel? People who know the Lord, they get excited. They get to tell what it is. Amen. They're like, oh, well, the gospel is this. And then they're glad to tell it. They're glad to, well, has the gospel come to your life? How did that happen? What happened with you? It's interesting how people who really love the Lord, they're glad to tell, well, that happened for me this way. And they gladly tell. But I've noticed something that sometimes when you ask certain people that question, what is the gospel and have you become a Christian? Has there come a point in your life where you have given your life to Christ and transferred trust from yourself to him and so forth? People have sometimes said, who are you to ask me that? Well, I'm a pastor for one thing. But they begin to say, who are you to ask me this? I remember that a long time ago at a church I was pastoring, Marcy and I were at a church, and I remember that a woman came to our church, and she was wanting to get together, and so I went to visit her in her home, and she was probably about 25 or 30 years older than I was, and myself and one of the other leaders went and sat down with her, and she began to just tell about all of these enormous broken relationships that she had at the church that she had come to us from. And she was talking about how this person did the wrong thing, and this person did the wrong thing, and this person did the wrong thing, and this person did the wrong thing. And then as we began to talk more and more, as she was telling me all about it, I just began to detect that she was very bitter, very angry, and in fact, as she was telling me the things that occurred, I was kind of going, wow, I think I kind of see the other people's point. And before very long, I just felt impressed of the Lord to begin to ask her about her own relationship with the Lord and her own salvation. That when she realized that that's what I was just simply asking about, she kicked me out of their home. How dare you question my faith? Friends, my New Testament says that we are to test ourselves. We are to test ourselves continually to see if we are in the faith. This is one you can't be wrong on. I mean, you can be wrong on a lot of things. You can mess up which fuel to buy. You can mess up this. You can mess up that. You can make mistakes in a lot of areas in life. You can't mess up whether or not you have saving faith in Jesus. There is eternity to bear. And so we see a glad heart to really look at our own hearts and to see if indeed we know God. So don't vilify someone who is questioning your faith. If you're truly in Christ, be glad that you have the opportunity to declare it. And it is very good in verifying your faith to really look at your own behavior and to see if it matches. Number three, carefully evaluate what kind of faith you have. Carefully evaluate what kind of faith you have. Is your faith merely intellectual and logical? Is your faith merely emotional and oriented toward feelings? Or have you come to a true trust and belief that Jesus is your only hope and that you have been given the keys to the kingdom, and so with joy and with gratitude you live for him? You see, someone who's been redeemed from their sins realizes the relief and the joy and the forgiveness that has been given to us, the weight that has been lifted. What is your kind of faith? Let me just say to you that if you have not come to true faith in Jesus alone, you can today. You can do that as we close this service. You can say, Lord, I need you. I've been trusting in my family. I've been trusting in feelings, or I've been trusting in emotions, or I've been trusting in intellect, what I know. But as I look at what James has said, I'm not sure that my life has been changed by you, God. The last one is this. Does your faith, here's the key phrase, dictate a difference in the way you live and what you do each day? Do you live as a Christian? What does that mean? Do you love God? Do you love others? James is saying here in verse 15, when you see the needs that are with you and around you, do you ignore them or do you meet those needs? Do you sacrifice? Is your life characterized by righteousness, or is your life characterized by flesh and conflict? God calls us to be a people who live and who walk by faith and not by sight in obedience. Would you pray with me?